Welcome to the VTU e-learning Shikshana program. I am Geeta Kumari, Dr. Geeta Kumari, and I am a professor in the civil engineering department of MS Rama Institute of Technology. Welcome to the unit in a steel structure compression members. I am handling this unit. So compression member, before going to the compression member, you should know few things. You should be learning the unit 1, unit 2, unit 3, that is the introductions. And the second one is what is bolt and welded connections. Then you might have studied the tension member, then come for the compression member. So this is the background need for the starting of the compression member. Then one more thing I want to tell, you should have the IS 800 2017 and along with the SP6, okay, steel tables you should have when we start with the problems. Now, what is compression member? Compression member is a structural member subjected to axial compression or compressive force are called compression members. Primarily occur as column in buildings, chord member in truss and diagonal members. That is, compression member generally comes to your mind is columns, isn't it? A vertical member always gets the compressive load. So in the chord member, in truss analysis you might have studied the in analysis of stress, what we will study, whether the member subjected to tension or compression, isn't it? So we have a compression member in the chord members of the trusses, diagonal members of the end panels of the trusses. Okay, these primarily occurs to our study. In addition to most of the common type of compression member, we have another compression member which includes arch ribs, rigid frame members, inclined or otherwise compression elements in the trusses. Okay, arch ribs, we'll see the figure. See here the figures of the, you can see the column. You can see the frame structure there. See here, you can observe the columns. You can see the crusher movement. See here, how the columns are built one by one above. Okay. See here, they have in for third figure, they have piled the I sections. You might have studied what is I sections, what is channel sections, and what are the T sections. What are the types of T sections, isn't it? So you have ISJB, ISMB, ISWB, ISHB. You know well versed with all these things. So generally we take ISMB or ISWB as the column members which have to take heavy loads which comes on the column. See here you can see the frame structure which are subjected to the compression member. So here I have shown a three hinged truss, okay, where the arch elements are subjected to compressive force. See here the steel rigid frame where the raft is subject to the compression. Stability is an important consideration. Why the stability is important? It's to be stable, isn't it? It should not fail. Whatever element we design for the stability. So stability is an important consideration for any design, not only for the columns, even for the tension member, whatever may be the structural element. Okay. The vertical member carrying axial load in building, we call it as a column or stanchions. Okay. So the what these columns are subjected? Columns are subjected to axial load through centroid. So through the centroidal axis of a vertical member, the whole load is transferred. It is subjected to axial load. A compression member in a roof truss is called strut. And in crane, it is called as boom. The same compression member in crane, where we shift the trusses, isn't it? Those things are called boom. So what is column? Column which are short are subjected to crushing. So if the column, you know, there are two types of columns. One is short column and long column. We'll come to later. So the column which is short, which is subjected to crushing, isn't it? It behaves, crushing behaves like a member under pure compression. The compressive force, only the compressive force is subjected to that, and it is under compression. Columns which are long, say little longer, they will bend, isn't it? The buckle out of the plane of the load of the axis. See here, in this figure, you can see the strut here. This is discontinuous strut, and this lengthy diagonal member, we can call it as a continuous strut. See this principal after is a continuous compression member or continuous strut. See here in the right side, this figure, this is a boom figure where we use to lift the trusses which is subjected to compressive force. Now, compression member failure. Why we have to study failures? Any design concepts which we have to study from the failures. When we apply the load, what happens in member? How it behaves? How it takes the bending moment? See, if it is a horizontal member, the prominent things are shear force and bending moment. If it is a vertical member, the most prominent thing is compressive force. So the critical force or buckling force, whatever you have studied in the strength of materials. So those things we have to consider here. So analysis of each element is prominent by those respective forces. So here, the failure of the column, what are the components, what are the, rather than components, what are the forces which makes the failure of the member? So failure of column lead to failure of the whole structure. So such a prominent element is column. Therefore, failure of column shall be avoided than any other element. So the failure of column is more important than the failure of any other element in the structure. Sorry. There are three basic types of column failure. First one is compressive metal failure. So the generally the compressive failure is done for the short columns, which are very short and fat. Then buckling failure, very long and skinny, generally very long and skinny, so that the bending moment takes place, the bending of the element takes place. A combination of both compressive and buckling failure along with the torsion also appears. Okay. Now squashing. Squashing is seen only in the short member where the crushing takes place. When the length of the column is relatively small and column is stocky and its component plates are prevent from the local buckling, then column will be able to attain its full strength before failing. So it crushes. That is called squashing. Then second one, buckling. So buckling, steel members are more suspected to buckle than the RC and PSC beams. Why? Why we say the steel members are more susceptible for buckling is they're more ductile. You have studied what are the properties of the steel in the strength of materials. So what is the nature of the steel? when it is in compression, when it is in tension, when it is in torsion, how it behaves. Okay, so here the buckling is the main criteria for the design of the column. So there are types of buckling. The first one is local buckling. Second one is overall flexural buckling. The third one is torsional buckling. Okay. So first one we discuss local buckling. What do you mean by local buckling? This occurs when some parts of the cross section of a column are so thin and they buckle locally. See, when in a manufacture of some faulty somewhere, you get a thin section that they buckle locally in compression before other modes of buckle can occur. Okay, so you can see this figure where the circle is there. Say here it may be the cross section thin, so it buckle there. So it may be a faulty of the material. Okay, so you can see here this figure where the junction, it has been buckled. This is the local failure of the local buckling only at that cross section. Now flexural buckling are also called the Euler buckling. This is the primary type of buckling what we see generally in the failure, which are subjected to bending or flexure when they become unstable. So when the load goes on apply on the column, at one point it will bend, isn't it? See, you can see here in this figure the bent shape. Okay. So this we call it as a flexural buckling. Then torsional buckling, I have shown the lateral torsion. Okay. See here, twisting of the, suppose a column is there, it has been twisted, and we call it as torsional buckling. This is due to torsion. What is torsion? When you apply two equal and opposite movements at the ends, both the ends. The buckling may take combination of any three-layer combination of flexure and torsion, combination of flexure and compression, so on. Okay. The buckling takes place when load value at which a straight column becomes unstable. When the load comes on the column, on a straight column, when it becomes unstable, that load we call it as critical load. When column bends at critical load, it is said it has buckled. Therefore, critical load is also called the buckling load. So we should know why it buckles. We have discussed due to bending, due to torsion, isn't it? So what are the other conditions also we have to study, factors affecting buckling? So here we have considered only three factors. There are many factors, but mainly these three factors which are considered for the buckling, those are end conditions. So when a column, what are the end condition? End conditions where means when the junction of the column and beam, column at the ends, okay, that is nothing but the junction of the column and beam, how the conditions are, whether it is fixed, whether it is hinged or roller, depends upon these things. We have to consider the factors which are affecting the buckling. So the end conditions, first end conditions is, So the end conditions also decides the effective length. So how much length actually it is carried upon? See, if it is a fixed, general speaking, when general we speak, when it is totally refixed, the column, it will take more load than the simply support, isn't it? So the end conditions also makes the effective length of the, which decides the effective length of the column. This you have matter studied in the RCC also. The same way here also we have an effective length. RT depends on the end conditions. So what are the end conditions? Rotations of end of the columns in building frame is usually limited by beams connecting to them. A column with fixed ends can support four times as much load as column with the pin ends. Pinned ends are hinged ends. So a column which is fixed can take four times the load when it is hinged than the hinged. So such is the connection affects the load carrying capacity. So effect of initial crookedness or eccentricity of load. Yes, when we talk about eccentricity, I said the columns which are subjected to loads at the centroid. Suppose it is practically, it's not highly impossible, exactly at the centroid, the longitudinal axis of through passes through the centroid, the load transfer. There, because of the different connections, different load patterns, it depends upon how it is away from the eccentricity, centroid. So the distance from the centroid to the load acting, we call it as eccentricity. So few loads are concentrated at the some distance from the centroidal axis, that eccentricity of loads. So what is the, how we have to consider this eccentricity means, we consider the eccentricity as load acting along the centroid with the moment. That's what we analyze in analysis, what we study. Whenever the load is acting away from the centroid, we consider a load, it is replaced by a load acting at the center with the moment. Okay. So the initial out of straightness, it is termed as initial crookedness or initial curvature. So it causes secondary bending moment. That's what I said. It is causing the moment as soon as compressive load is applied, which in turn leads to further bending deflection. So this, again, the eccentricity load, which makes the additional movement rather than the buckling, the additional movement to the buckling. You can see in this figure, see, here you can see the eccentric load which causes the movement. A stable deflected shape is possible as long as external movement, the product of the load and the lateral deflection, does not exceed the internal movement resistance of any section. Okay. Next comes the effect of residual stresses. Complete yielding of cross section does not occur until applied strain equal to yield strain of the base material. The residual stresses does not affect the load corresponding to full yield of the cross section. So what is this residual stresses? The stresses which are induced in the member at the particular section. If you see the figure, you'll come to understand. See this figure. Example of residual stresses due to hot rolling. See here, you can see the compression in the flange, again tension and compression. Okay, so 0.3 of Fi yield stress. Then you can see tension, compression and tension in the web. Okay, again at the bottom flange you can see compression, tension and compression. So these are some percentages of the stress has been induced by the manufacturing. So here the second figure you can see the example of residual stresses due to welding. So when welding has taken place, so some stresses has been induced in the material. See here you can see the stresses, how they have induced in the cross section of the I section when it is welded at the junction of web and the flange. You can see this welded portion. So this stresses has been initiated in the and forms the residual stresses. Then coming to the effective length, I talked about the eccentric loading, effective length, isn't it? So effective length, when both ends are pinned, what will be the effective length? There original length equal to effective length. L is the original length and LE is the effective length. So here whatever may be the length of the column is equal to the effective length of the column. So whole column has been taken. See, one end fixed, the other end is free. When this is the condition, see here the bottom end is fixed, the top end is free and the load is applied, then the effective length is considered as 2 times the length. See the bend shape. So this becomes my effective length. See here this L is the original length. So one end fixed, other end free means the effective length what we get is more, twice the length of the original column. When both ends are fixed, see here you can see when both ends are fixed, the effective length is nothing but only the 0.5 times the original length. Okay, so here K equal to 0.5, that is what the factor, effective length equal to KL, then K is nothing but 0.5. Here, that was the K indicated here. Okay, so L effective is K into L, so K is 0.5. when one end is pinned or hinged, the other end is fixed, what will be your effective length? So here K value becomes 0.7, so effective length is 0.7 times the original length. Now, the tendency of column to buckle usually measured by its slenderness ratio. So slenderness ratio is nothing but the length, effective length divided by R. That's the formula, where R is the radius of gyration, which is gives the square root of I by A. What is I? I is the moment of inertia and A is the cross-sectional area. You well versed with all this radius of gyration. Then compression member versus tension member. So when we consider the comparative study between the compression member versus tension member, effect of first one, effect of material imperfection and flaw. So what happens if material imperfection is there and any flaw in the material? How we treat with the tension member, how we treat the compression member? Slight imperfection in the tension member are can be safely discarded as they are little consequence. So if a slight defect, some imperfection in the tension member can be disregarded as it is a little consequence. It won't cause us much trouble to the load carrying capacity. On the other hand, slight defect in the column are greater significance. Why? We are compressing it, isn't it? So the material which everything in that part should get compressed, if some defect or some slight imperfection also causes the greater significance and local buckling takes place. A column that is slightly bent at the time it is put in plinth may have significant bending results from the load and initial lateral deflection. That's what it induces, the local buckling and deflection. Then second thing, tension member causes lengthening of the member. If you apply pulls at the both the ends, which lengthens, elongates the member, isn't it? When you compare with the compression, it pushes, isn't it? So compression besides forces causing buckling of the member. Here just elongates it, here it buckles it, it bends it. And third thing, presence of holes in bolted connection reduces the cross-sectional area in tension member. Why? Why we remove holes in the design of the tension member which are drilled for the bolt? Because when you apply the tensile force, the area which having the hold cannot take the tensile force at all. So you have to remove that area. But when you compare to the same thing to the compression member, even the bolt which is there, the presence of bolt is also contributes the compressive load. So that carries the compressive load along with the, because we are pressing it. In between bolts are there, even those are experiencing the compressive force. So we have to consider those things. Column more critical than the tension member. Why? Why a column is critical than beam or tension member? Because a minor imperfection in the material and dimension will have a great deal in the column or a compression member rather than the tension member. So you have to take more care of the material in the where it is subjected to compression. The material importance is homogeneity and the combination of the material, okay, what can I take, chemical compositions, whatever it is, should be of very carefully, it should be taken, and it is have a great deal, the material property have a great deal in the compression member rather than in the tension member. Column more critical than tension member. Why? The bending of tension member probably will not be serious as the tensile load tends to straighten those members. So when you apply the tensile, it will elongate, it will straighten further, isn't it? But in bending of the compression member, serious thing happen is it will bend and it will buckle. It magnifies the bending. Now coming to the sections used for the compression. What are the sections we use for the compression member? If you take a theoretical thing, we can use any shape, but in practice we have a particular types of sections which can be used in practice. Why we call particular sections means we have to connect it to the beam, isn't it? And further composite columns you have to make. Further you will get column above that, one more column in the another floor. So because of so many constraints, we have specified the particular sections can be used as a compression member. So for the practical point of view, the number of possible solution is several, limited to section availability, connection problem and type of structure, section to be used. So these are the types of compression member. You can use a single angle. So angle section you might have studied. equal and unequal angles. Equal angle means both the legs of an L section. L section is called angle section. So both the legs are equal means we call it as equal angle section. And unequal angle section where the both the legs are not equal. So in the second figure we have double angle. You can see the double angle back to back. They are back to back. This forms a compression member. Then we have a T-shaped. So T-shaped member can be used as the compression member. And channel sections. C-sections are called channel sections. So channel sections can be used as compression member. Then I-section. You can see this first one. I-section can be used as compression member. And hollow, say pipe or round tube, that is hollow section. Circular hollow section can be used as the compression member. Or square tubing is also can be used as compression member. And rectangular tubing is also can be used. Then you have, see here, I have a four angles. You can see the four angles which forms the box section, okay, can be used. Then here, channel sections are used. Instead of four angles, here we have a channel sections. And here two channel sections back to back, more popular section. We use two channels back to back. This forms a box section, can be used as compression member. See here, if further more load has to be taken where single element cannot be possible, whatever available, see your SP6, whatever available, I sections, L sections, T sections, those things, addition to them, suppose if load carrying capacity should be more, then we provide the extra elements on it. So they are called built-up sections. So in that built-up sections, what types you can take is I section. See here you have a plate, a top and bottom has been connected, and which we call it as a cover plates. I with cover plates, the I section with the cover plates. Here I section with the channels. See, you can see the channels at the top and the bottom. See here, built up, say a single plate has been taken. Okay, for that here the angles has been attached. So this can be taken as a compression member. Then one more here we have, see channels, four channels, you have one plate you have and two cover plates at the top and the bottom. So this also can make you the built-up section for the compression member. Then comes to very important point is slenderness ratio. Already we have talked about it, but here on a specific heading I am telling about the slenderness ratio. Slenderness ratio is denoted by lambda. Okay, slenderness ratio is equal to effective length of the column divided by minimum radius of variation. If lambda is more, its load carrying capacity will be less. So if lambda is more than say 1.5 and above, so the load carrying capacity will be less. That's what it means. Now the short compression member is where L by R is less than or equal to 88.85 for yield strength of 250 MPa and failure stress equal to yield strength. When the short column reaches the yield stress, then it fails, not by buckling, only by crushing. So short compression member always fails by squashing, that is crushing. Then long compression member they will be buckle elastically. Axial buckling stress is below proportional limit. Then only the elastic buckling takes place within the elastic limit, the long compression member, how it buckles. So there are many combinations of the length, okay, cross-sectional area, and so many factors which include in the buckling, what we have discussed. All these influences the column buckling. So what we made, we prepared, we have a buckling curve in the IS 800, okay, which represents the influence of residual stresses and geometric imperfection on buckling failure behavior of the member. These influences are most pronounced for intermediate values of the slenderness ratio 0.5 to 1.5. So the curve, so taking all the effects they have plotted and they prepared the curves. So classification of different sections under different buckling classes. There are four classes of buckling, A, B, C, D, depends upon their yield strength and the material imperfection. Material, we have classified them. It is given in the table 10 of the IS 800 2007, page number 44. The stress reduction factor and design compressive strength for different buckling classes, yield stress and effective slenderness ratio is given in the table 8 of page 37 and table 9 in page 40. Show the design compressive strength FCD for different buckling classes from A to D. So depends upon which class it comes, these particular member. So we consider the particular class and refer the table, then get the value of stress reduction factor and the design compressive strength. So you can see this figure. These curves, the curves corresponds to different buckling class A, B, C, D. The curve corresponding to different buckling class are presented in non-dimensional form as shown in figure below. Using this curve, one can find the value of design compressive stress for effective slenderness ratio, which is given in page 35 of IS 800. So this figure, the buckling classes and the cross sections are shown. Cannot magnify anything. Okay, see here, table 10 of the IS 800, you can see this I section, limits and buckling about the axis A, B, C, these things are given. In next class, we will study what are the design criterias and how the members are being used as the compression member in the design of the members can be analyzed. This is table 11, where effective length of prismatic compression member it is given. I have taken the snapshot of the IS 800, page number 45, where it is the effective length of the member is given. Here we cannot see clearly. See, if one end is restrained, okay, transition and rotation, one end is restrained, the other end is both free, transitionally and rotationally, that is free end, the length will be 2L. See, here hinged, both are hinged, it is 1L. Okay, when one end is fixed, the other end hinge is 0.8L. When both ends are fixed, it is 0.65L. So in next table, it is clearly given effective length of compression member. See, boundary conditions. Both ends are pinned. Theoretically, it is one. Even caudal also, it is one. Both ends are fixed means 0.5 L theoretically. But caudal value says it is 0.65 L. The effective length is 0.65 times the original length. When one end is fixed and the other end is pinned, 0.707 L for a theoretical, and for a caudal it is given 0.8 L. One end is fixed, other end is free. Theoretically it is 2 times the original length. Even caudally it is 2 times the original length. This is the end conditions we have to consider for the calculation of length of the member, the effective length of the member. See, design of compression strength. In class number 7.1.2, the design compressive strength PD of a member is given by P should be less than PD. The whatever the load which comes on the member should be less than the design. So for a particular value, if you have designed, that should be greater than the whatever the value exactly comes on it. When we do the design problem, you'll come to know. Because there comes the factor of safety. So the factor of safety will be 1.5 times. 1.5, if you divide, then that should be the load carrying capacity of the member. That is safe load, what we are talking about, the safe load. See, where the design load is equal to AE into FCD, that is given in the code book, where AE is the effective sectional area defined in class number 7.3.2, and FCD is the design compressive stress obtained as per 7.1.2.1. Okay, so these two are important to know. What is the design strength? See, effective sectional area, what do you mean by that? Except as modified in 3.7.2 class 4, the cross-sectional area shall be taken as effective sectional area for all compression member fabricated by welding, bolting and riveting so long as section is semi-compact or better. Holes not filled with rivets, bolts or pins shall be deducted. If rivets and bolts are present in that, we won't deduct any holes at all from the gross area to calculate the effective sectional area. In the tensile member, we take effective area where we remove the holes made for the bolts and rivets. In IS 800-2007, class number 7.1.2.1, what it states, the design compressive stress FCD of axial loaded compression member should be calculated using this following equation. There are two types. You can use this equation, or we have a ready-made charts in the IS 800. When the problems comes, we can discuss that. 9A, 9B, 9C, 9D, like that. Depends upon the class. We have the buckling class. We have the charts. So directly you can use the charts by knowing the slenderness ratio. That is more comfortable. Then calculating this calculation, you get the same answer. Okay. So these formula, using these formulas only, the charts have been prepared. So FCD equal to Fy by RMO, that is partial safety factor divided by 5 plus 5 square minus lambda square to the power 0.5. Okay, where Fy is the yield stress divided by RMO should be less than or equal to Fy by RMO, where phi equal to 0.5 into 1 plus alpha multiplied by 5 minus 0.2 plus multiplied by lambda minus 0.2 plus lambda square. You can see the equation where lambda is non-dimensional effective slenderness ratio. What is the slenderness ratio? Effective length, already we have discussed. Effective length by R minimum, minimum radius of gyration. So the lambda equation is given. In that you have Fy by FCC under root. What is FCC? Euler buckling stress, that is pi square E divided by KL by R whole square. KL by R is effective slenderness ratio or ratio of effective length. KL to appropriate radius of gyration R. Alpha is the imperfection factor given in table 7. Below it's there. Imperfection factor alpha. See, for the buckling class A, B, C, D, you have to consider alpha 0.21. For B class, it is 0.34. For C class, it is 0.49. D class, 0.76. Then X is the stress reduction factor. You have in the table 8. For different buckling classes and centeredness ratio, that is given by the following formula. Okay. Then YMO, XMO, sorry, partial safety factor for material strength. Then the design steps. What are the design steps for the compression member? For an average column size, say 3 to 5 meters, generally the column ranges from 3 to 5 until it is specified. Okay, we consider it is generally from 3 to 5 meters. Then the slenderness ratio of 40 to 60 is selected. If it is a very long column, the slenderness ratio of 60 may be assumed. For a column with heavy factored load, a smaller value of slenderness ratios to be assumed. This we consider while design problems. Okay. If it is a heavy load, we have to consider a smaller value of slenderness ratio. Okay. Choose a trial section by assuming appropriate slenderness ratio. We have to try taking a section, okay, and calculate the slenderness ratio. Say for a single angle, the slenderness ratio should lie 1/30th of the length of the strut, that is L by R, approximately 150. Say if it is a double angle, 1/35 of the length of the strut, that is from 100 to 120. If it is a circular hollow section, okay, we will take 1/40th of the length, okay, as the slenderness ratio. Assumption made in design of compression member. What are the assumptions we make in the design of compression member are, the column is assumed to be absolutely straight. We assume it. The modulus of elasticity is assumed to be constant in the built-up column. That is, modulus of elasticity is assumed to be constant, means it is made up of same material. If you are combining with different and different material, again, the design will be more complicated. And hence, what we do, we take the modulus of elasticity. In the steel also, we take the same material. There may be many types of steel, you know that. So the built-up column is made up of same material. That what it means, modulus of elasticity is constant. The secondary stresses are neglected. Okay. Then calculate FCD and the design strength. Suppose a member is given. Okay, you find the slenderness ratio. How you find effective length by R minimum, isn't it? So once you get R minimum, you find the slenderness ratio. Once you get the slenderness ratio, see the column as table 10 and get the which class it belongs to. Go to that chart, 9A, 9B, 9C, 9D, and calculate the lambda value for the calculated lambda value. What is the allowable compressive strength FCD? You calculate, then multiply with the area that gives the design strength. Those are the first problems what we are to in the problem sections. For the estimating value of slenderness ratio, calculate the design compressive strength FCD by method using buckling curve or by using equation. So two methods you can use. Okay, that is given in IS 800 2007, class number 7.1.2. The design strength of the member is calculated. Okay, PD equal to FCD, effective cross sectional area. The value PD should be more than the factored load PU. PU is 1.5 times the safe load, isn't it? So should be more than, the design load should be more than the ultimate load of the member, so that it will be safe. So this is the background required to start with the problems. So the next class will be the problems. There are types of problems. Okay, first type, when the member is given, how to find out the compressive strength. The second type will be when load is given, how to find the, choose the member. The third type, how you provide the lacings and battens with bolted and welded connections.